Okay, the next item of business is consideration of business motion 10622 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland Bill. I'd ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now, and I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've been waiting in anticipation for 50 minutes for this, but moved.
Thank you very much indeed. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 10622 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. The next item of business is a Stage 3 proceedings of the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland Bill. In dealing with amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that's SP Bill 19A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for around 5 minutes for the first division of the Stage 3. The period of voting for the first division will be 45 seconds. Thereafter, I'll allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons or enter RTS in the chat function if they're joining us online as soon as possible after the group is called. Members should now refer to the marshal list of amendments. Point of order, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm finding it very difficult to hear you from up here. I don't know if there's anything that can be done.
Well, I could probably speak louder, Ms. Dunbar. Thank you very much indeed. And that's what I'll endeavour to do. Now we move to Group 1, Major Incidents, and I call Amendment 9 in the name of Jackie Bailey, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Jackie Bailey to move Amendment 9 and speak to all other amendments in the group. Ms. Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I wish to move Amendment 9 and will speak to all other amendments in this group. These six amendments are all related and taken together will strengthen the rights of bereaved families within the bill. These amendments seek to ensure that patients who have been seriously injured or harmed in a healthcare setting are never again left struggling to get answers and justice. This suite of amendments and the ones that follow in Group 3 are the basis for putting Millie's Law into effect. Taken together, the amendments will deliver a duty to advocate for those affected by a major incident in a healthcare setting, a patient safety charter for the benefit of patients and their families that we'll come on to, a duty to ensure patients affected by a major incident are aware of the Commissioner's role, a duty to provide patients affected with information and details that will support them, and a duty to provide information to whistleblowers on how to disclose information relating to a major incident. May I remind members why this is just so important? Millie Main was 10 years old and in remission from leukaemia when she tragically lost her life to an infection that was believed to have been caused by the water supply in the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. Her mum, Kimberly, has had to battle to get answers, compounding her pain at what was an unimaginably difficult time. And she is not the only family member who has had to fight alone for answers in a situation like this. Louise Lawrence, a grieving widow who lost her husband in the Queen Elizabeth Hospital infection scandal and who Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board chose to pay a private company to spy on, is still waiting for a meeting with the Health Board that was promised by the former First Minister. But both Louise and Kimberley are still awaiting the outcome of the Queen Elizabeth public inquiry. For those of us with even longer memories, I also want to mention the C. diff scandal that happened at the Vale of Leven Hospital. These are illustrations of where having a patient safety commissioner with robust powers would have been so important. So let me address the amendments in turn. Amendment 9 would add to the duties of the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland, meaning that they would be required to advocate for those affected by a major incident, while Amendment 20 defines the term major incident itself. Amendment 17 would introduce a new section to the bill relating to the Commissioner's role once they are made aware of a major incident. This would include patients affected by major incidents and the families of patients who died as a result of them, providing relevant information, including sources of support, information on accessing legal advice and representation, details of any investigations or inquiries relating to the incident, and of course advice to whistleblowers. Significantly, the amendment would also require the Commissioner to consider initiating a formal investigation into an incident within 1 year of becoming aware of it. My amendments don't seek to hinder the work of the Commissioner, and indeed Amendment 17 requires the Commissioner to consider initiating a formal investigation, but it does not require them to then carry out that investigation. So we're trying to be proportionate here. Amendment 21 defines the term family member for the purpose of identifying who should be contacted by the Commissioner in the event of a major incident. And under Amendment 18, where the Commissioner completes a formal investigation, they would be required to provide a copy of their report into the incident to both the police and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. The amendment also confirms that the report could be used in legal proceedings. Under the bill as it stands, the Patient Safety Commissioner does not have the power to make redress or assist those seeking redress or opine on actions that should be taken in relation to individuals. However, Amendment 10 would ensure that major incidents are exempt from that element of the bill. The amendments would empower the Patient Safety Commissioner to advocate for people that have been failed by the healthcare system. They would ensure that those who are affected by such incidents are supported in knowing their rights and getting the appropriate help. By empowering the role of the Commissioner, we can begin to reset the balance between families and powerful public bodies. I move Amendment 9 in my name.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call Tess White.
Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I rise to support Jackie Bailey's amendments in this group. The Queen Elizabeth University Hospital scandal has haunted families for years. Families who are desperately seeking answers from a health board that has pulled down the shutters and said nothing to see here. We saw the same thing happen in NHS Tayside in the Sam Eljamel case, whose medical negligence has had devastating consequences for his patients. Patients and their families should not have to go up against a large public body to find out the truth, and in no way is that a fair fight. The Scottish Government announced the Scottish Hospitals Inquiry in 2019 on the QEUH campus and a public inquiry earlier this month on Eljamel. These inquiries are welcome, but they can take years and leave families in limbo. Against this background, it makes sense for the Patient Safety Commissioner to advocate for those affected by a major incident in a healthcare setting where they believe it is appropriate to do so. These amendments are, however, a significant expansion of the Patient Safety Commissioner's remit with implications for resourcing. And if they're successful today, and I hope they will be after the SNP and Greens rejected them at stage two, the Commissioner will need to be able to deliver on them. I hope the Minister and Jackie Bailey will be able to address this point. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White. I now call on the Minister. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to begin by acknowledging the voices of patients who have been harmed while in the care of the NHS or any other healthcare provider, and those of their families and loved ones. I can only begin to imagine the grief of those families who have been bereaved, and my heart goes out to them for the devastating loss they have suffered. Families have spoken clearly and powerfully about how the healthcare system has let them down, and in Jackie Bailey's words, they've had to battle. The best thing any of us can do now, in fact the only thing we can do, is to take every step possible to make sure that other families don't suffer the same thing in the future. I would like to record my thanks to Jackie Bailey for her continued support and advocacy for these patients and their families, and for working with us towards our common aim of making this bill and the Patient Safety Commissioner as strong as possible. None of us will ever forget in these discussions that we all want to make healthcare safer. That has been at the forefront of my mind since I started working on the bill, and I know the same is true of all of us in this chamber. As I noted at stage two, the Patient Safety Commissioner's role is to amplify the voice of patients and drive improvements in safety however they see fit. The Commissioner will have powers to investigate any healthcare safety issue, and listening to patients and their families is a fundamental element of their role. I know from my discussions with her that Jackie Bailey's amendments seek to strengthen the Commissioner even further to ensure that the voices of those harmed in major healthcare incidents and families who have lost loved ones are heard. The Patient Safety Commissioner will undoubtedly wish to hear the voices of bereaved families as well as affected patients when they wish to raise an issue relating to patient safety that stems from the sort of incident Jackie Bailey describes. That is something that is already provided for in the bill. Indeed, as a government, our key consideration when developing the bill has been to give the Patient Safety Commissioner as much independence as possible so that they have the most freedom possible to examine any healthcare issue that affects patients and their families. The most important thing we can do now is to do our best to ensure that no families see loved ones harmed while in the care of the healthcare system. That is why it's so important that this bill improves patient safety by encouraging openness, learning and cooperation within the healthcare system so that when things go wrong, lessons are learnt and families do not go through the same things again. Now, while I understand the intent behind Amendment 10, I believe that it is likely to detract from that vital function I've just described, to encourage openness, ensure lessons are learned and prevent the same harms happening again. Adding to the Commissioner's role a function of providing or assisting with redress for patients and bereaved families and giving their opinions on the actions that others should take in light of past incidents risks putting the Commissioner into an adversarial role and may encourage healthcare providers to believe that they have to be defensive as opposed to open in their dealings with the Commissioner. I believe that focusing the Commissioner on openness and learning rather than redress for past incidents will be the best way of ensuring that when they look into any healthcare safety issues connected to a major incident where many patients are harmed, lessons are learned and those harms are not repeated. Similarly, Amendment 21 provides an extensive list of definitions of what constitutes family, which I know Jackie Bailey has drafted with the sole intention of ensuring that no family member is excluded from being able to speak to the Commissioner or receive support. However, family means different things to different people, and the family connections that are important to one person will not necessarily be the same as to the next. I also believe some of the language in this amendment on whole blood and half blood relationships is outdated. I believe it's more effective not to tie the Commissioner up with lengthy definitions of who they should or should not consider in the context of their work. That is a matter for the Commissioner's own discretion. We all share the desire for the Patient Safety Commissioner to be able to look into healthcare safety issues arriving from major incidents where multiple patients are harmed. I've considered very carefully how best to achieve this. And my view remains that it is more effective to allow the Commissioner to be guided by patients on the issues they look into and the actions they take. I do not wish to inadvertently tie the Commissioner's hands in respect of the sort of circumstances they can look into. And I worry that this group of amendments, by adding very specific steps for the Commissioner to take in relation to certain group of incidents, would unintentionally undermine the Commissioner's vital ability to set their own agenda and to look into the issues of most concern to patients. It remains the case that following a major incident relating to healthcare safety, the Commissioner would have an important role in hearing from those affected and considering whether a systemic problem has caused it. I must emphasise again, as this point is very important, that there is nothing in the powers and functions already in the bill preventing the Commissioner from doing this. I therefore urge members not to support these amendments.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Jackie Bailey to wind up and press a withdrawal amendment 9. Ms. Bailey.
Well, there you go, Presiding Officer. I listened very, very carefully to the Minister's response. There is much on which we agree, but the warm words are not a substitute for action. And it's one thing to acknowledge the voices of families, but not to listen to them when they describe this as the action required to give the commissioner the powers that the families say are necessary. So I have to say, I am genuinely disappointed. Can I thank Tess White and the Conservatives for their support? Can I point out to the Minister that the First Minister himself said he supported Milley's Law, but his government doesn't appear to do so? How can he change his mind so quickly, or is it the case that he is not actually in control of this legislation? Can I also say that I spent a considerable amount of time engaging with the Minister and her officials, time that I thought was well spent. Unfortunately, that doesn't appear to have been the case. And I have listened to her very carefully, and I will withdraw Amendment 21 because the Minister has confirmed on the record that the widest definition of family will be considered, and I'm content with that. But let me say to her, if she thinks that this will make healthcare providers more defensive than they already are, then I am quite astonished, because you only need to look at the evidence, at the attitude of healthcare providers, of healthcare managers at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital, at Tayside in relation to El Jamel, to understand that healthcare providers are defensive already, and we need to change the balance. We need to get things back to the patient being at the centre of everything we do. Giving effect to Milley's Law should be something that this Parliament should do. And in closing, let me reflect on Milley's mum, Kimberly Darroch's own words. Right now, the system is stacked against those who have questions about what happened to their loved ones, and that can't be right. We are looking to our Parliament to put measures in place so that nobody has to go through what we went through ever again. I hope members will reflect on her words and reject the Minister's approach and support these amendments.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. Parliament is not agreed. There'll be a division, as this is the first division of Stage 3. I'm going to suspend for around 5 minutes to allow members to get onto the digital voting platform.